So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
Let's sing this part out together. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Let's lift our voice.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 No one. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting the battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion. What a wonderful name.
Jesus, your name is powerful. Your name has the power to save. Your name has the power to redeem us. And God, all of us in this room, we stand on the same ground that we have sinned. We have fallen short of your glory, but you did not leave us on our own, but you sent your Son, Jesus, to take our sin, to be the perfect sacrifice for us. He was the Lamb of God who was slain for us. So God, today I pray for anyone who's here, someone maybe in particular here who feels just so disconnected from you, so alone. And I pray that they would know that there is a loving Father who longs for them to know his presence and the power of the resurrection of Christ. I pray for those of us today, God, who feel just this distance from you, that you would bridge that gap between us and you, and that we would know that you are for us, that you are not against us. And there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of death has set, the law of the Spirit of life has set us free from the law of sin and death, God. And that is our hope. So we look to you today. We pray that through the message you would speak to us. And we pray all this in your name. Everybody said, amen. You may be seated, and let's check out this video.
Well, good morning. We're going to get back to worship in a moment. But I want to break in here and kind of give you some content here, give you more or less the morning message now, so that we can kind of go from there into a kind of a time of worship. You know, this series has all been about figuring out how to stay married. For those who fall in love, can they stay in love for a lifetime? On the wedding day, that's what they hope for, isn't it? Everybody does. We come to that moment where, you know, the bride and the groom, and they take their vows and they say, I do, and you want that. Every person wants that. You know what? I think that's the imprimatur of God in us. That's the fingerprint, the handprint of God that says love is for a lifetime. It's forever. That's what we all believe. That's what we all think, at least then. But you know that for some people, it doesn't happen that way. It doesn't go that way. And you know that as the years go on, that person that you committed to, that you said, I will love you forever, now suddenly there's a change of heart, and you're like, oh, I hate them forever, you know? Now, some of you know how it is, and you feel the pain of that. Maybe you've heard somebody say, I bet some of you have heard somebody say this, well, I just don't love them anymore, or I don't feel love for them anymore. I have a picture inside of my premarital counseling book. You know, I have this notebook, and every couple that I marry, I go through a series of premarital counseling sessions, and I have a picture in the very front of one of the very first couples that I ever married. And they took their vows, and they said, I do, and I was extremely close to this couple. And just a couple of years after they said, I do, she came to me saying, I just don't love him anymore. I don't feel love for him anymore. And they got a divorce, and it was a painful experience. And I keep that picture there at the front of my notebook, that premarital notebook, just to remind me what the stakes are. How important this moment is with the couple. You've known people that have said, I do, and then later say, I don't. And like I said, maybe you were in that kind of a relationship, and man, it was painful, that breakup. Somewhere along the road, somewhere through the journey, those feelings turned sour. The emotions ebbed, and they all went away. And today, we're here to ask the question, how do you deal with what you feel? What happens when? What happens when in our marriages, in our relationships, how about what happens in our relationship with God when those feelings start to wane? And they will. And we're here to discover what that is. So yes, this is for you married people, pay attention, but I hope you understand this is for everybody here. In so many situations, relationships, circumstances of our lives, emotions. How do you deal with what you feel? Now, let's just be really open and honest here to understand the culture in which we live in, right? We are living in romanticized times where the heart is king, right? Feelings. It's all about feelings. Nothing more than feeling. And our songs of the day, the songs that people sing, the top 40, what's popular, really gives you an insight into the ethos of our culture, doesn't it? You know, the songs that are out there, you know, whatever decade you live in, the songs of the day speak to the belief system, the faith system of the culture. And I'm really excited about next week. We start a brand new series entitled Lyrics. For the next 5 or 6 weeks, we are going to look at the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, and we're going to look at the song of the decade, you know, one of the popular song of the decade. So next week, make sure you bring your bell bottoms and wear your tie-dye t-shirts, okay? I know you got them in your closet. And we're going to have a great time together, and we're going to have fun with this series. And we're going to see, what does the Bible say about the ethos of the day, the belief system of the decade. Like I said, it's kind of in and surrounds those songs. Well, Let's get back to the emotions and the feelings of the day. It's all about the heart, right? And so oftentimes, romantic love can become romantic love. It's all about romantic love, and we can idolize romanticism. We can idolize the heart, the feelings that we have for one another. Case in point, let's look at some of these songs, all right? Let's have some fun here. All right, some of you know these songs. By Sting, Sacred Love. You're my religion, baby. Okay, baby's not there. I'm just inserting that. That's what he's saying. You're my religion. You're my church, baby. You're my holy grail at the end of my search. Wow, it rhymes too, you know? I mean, we're thinking about doing this as a worship song some Sunday morning. No, we're not. Look at that. I mean, he's just really blatant, right? How about this next one? How many of you know the singer Hozer? Am I pronouncing this right? Hozer? Okay, you can tell I don't know who Hozer is, but anyhow, Hozer, take me to church. She tells me, worship in the bedroom. Yeah, that's what he says there. The only heaven, he should have been here last week, right? That would have been a good one for, the only heaven I'll be sent is when I'm alone with you, baby. Wow. Come on. And then from my era, my love, there's only you in my life, right? And then, Lionel Richie, and then Diana Ross, my first love. I won't sing it. I really won't. You're every breath I take. You're every step I, like, you're my all in all. It's like, come on. Really? So you see what I mean? We can make a God out of our feelings, a God out of romantic love. Now, I'm not against feelings. I don't think that we should become these automatons, these computerized robots, you know, and walk around and, you know, straight-laced and stiff-necked and all. But we got to understand the right place of emotions, because we can go usually so oftentimes in one of two directions, two extremes of emotions, right? And some of you here are going to represent one of these two extremes. First of all, emotionalism. Some of you here are gushers. You know who you are. In other words, if you're just not sharing your soul, you're just not sharing. And you expect everybody around you to share their soul. Let's see some tears, some weeping and a wailing, you know? That's what life is all about. You just got to get it out. How many of you got gushers? Any gushers here in the crowd? Yeah, thank you for admitting it. Yeah, we love you guys. We really do. But then there are the other side, the Stoics. Stoicism. You're not gushers, you're stuffers. In other words, emotions, bah, humbug, fooey on youy about feelings, right? How many Stoics do we have? Yeah, see, there are many more of you who are Stoics. You just don't want to raise your hand in church because that's emotional, right? That's what you just don't do that in church. You don't raise your hands in church. Come on, sit on those hands. You know what's really funny about this? Is that there are Christian denominations, are there not, represented in these two views. Some of you are nodding your heads. You know what I mean. You've been there. You signed up for that. And, you know, there's a brand of Christianity we'd call more emotional. If you don't quiver in the liver, then it's not worship. You know, you got to show some emotion in the ocean of devotion, and you just pour yourself out in worship, and you dance and scream and holler. Yeah, we know who you are. You've been down here in front before. I know that. I've seen you. And then there are those of you who have come more from a stoical tradition, and you fold your hands, and you are what we would call the frozen chosen. Yes, you are. And you know what? When I thought about this, I hate to admit this to you, I have been a member of both of these sides here, which my family would tell you that makes me a psychopath, probably. You know, I'm schizophrenic. We got to understand that emotions are created by God, are they not? You know, we're not saying that feelings are bad. We're just saying it's important to understand their place. God designed emotions to be gauges, not guides. They're indicators. They're like the light bulb, the emergency light that signal that's going off and saying something is wrong. They don't have to rule you. They are just kind of letting you know something's wrong inside. You know, we have this national defense system. You know, when a nation starts firing rockets at us, those beeps and sounds and lights start going off. And that's kind of like in us. God created our hearts to have kind of that way about us so we can figure out, oh, wait, there's something going on. You know, maybe I'm being violated. Maybe I'm being abused. Maybe I should be a little bit upset at what's going on here. They stole my sandwich out of the lunchroom refrigerator. But they're not supposed to regulate, control my life. We're not to be managed by our feelings. All right, let's see how this plays out just for a moment. There's four parts of an experience, aren't there? First of all, there's the event. There's the objective thing that happens. This is really quick. Just the event itself that happens. Secondly, there's the interpretation, which is highly subjective. How we see it, what we think about it, what we interpret it to be. And again, highly subjective is then our emotion, our feeling that gets attached. And then finally, the behavioral response, the reaction to it all. Let's do an experiment, an example here, shall we? A man, a husband, brings home a dozen red roses to his wife, right? I mean, she thinks, how loving, how sweet is he? Or she could think, he's up to something. Okay, let's not show any hands here. No nudging going on right now. It could be either or. Then the emotion, one could be security and love and you know, feeling good, to suspicion. You know, he's cheating on me. So, you know, he did something wrong. He gambled away his paycheck or something like that. And then the reaction is a cold shoulder at the very best or at the very worst. You know, I don't know. So you see how feelings can go one way or the other. One day they're up, one day they're down. They're so unreliable. And they can trick us. And so we've got to ask ourselves the question this: do you manage your feelings or do they manage you? Some of you are very, very bad at this. We would call that emotionally unhealthy. We would call that a sickness. And some of you are really sick deep within, and you may not understand it and realize it. But see this and hear this out. This is so critical. And this applies not just to marriages. It applies to all of life. But let me just hit marriages for a minute. That your marriage cannot grow past the level of emotional health. You know, if emotionally health is a 1 to 10 on the spectrum, and you're at a 2, and your spouse is at a 2, and you have a combined total of a 4, guess what? You're going to have a lot of problems. You're going to have some terrible difficulties. Do you know what? This applies to so many other areas of our lives, though. You cannot grow spiritually. Some of you are going to have a hard time hearing this. You can't grow spiritually until you have become emotionally healthy. In other words, the two go hand in hand. You can't pray away. You can't pray and cover over your emotional unhealthiness. In other words, you can't just stuff it and put it aside. No amount of Bible or theology is going to somehow work or undo or heal the emotional unhealthiness of your soul. The two go hand in hand. So hear me well. This applies to absolutely everybody today. And we want to look at the problem of the heart first, and then we're going to look at the solution, shall I say, and may I say, the only solution for our heart. A lot of times we come into marriage, right, with this kind of very dependent attitude. We're dependent upon our spouse for happiness, for joy, for security, for confidence. And in a perfect world, and if my spouse is perfect, all is well, right? They're perfect, I'm perfect, and therefore everybody's getting what they want. But guess what? We don't have that always. Because in my life, I've got baggage. And let me tell you, Doug Gies has baggage. You know, I think for Joanne and myself, we were some of the walking wounded. Me probably more than her. I came through situations where I was not healthy, emotionally speaking. Literally during my teen years, I was fearing marriage and commitment because all the people around me were getting divorced, and my parents, and there were friends and in our church and family members, and I was kind of a little goofed up, emotionally speaking. And so when you come into a marriage and you bring that baggage with you, the stuff with you, that stuff is going to bleed into the relationship. Let me illustrate that now. Let me introduce you to a couple of friends of mine. Mr. and Mrs. Mug. Oops, she's already losing her beads. Settle down. Mr. and Mrs. Mug, when they first started dating, you know, it was bliss. It was heaven. You know, Mr. Mug looked at her and said, "Woo, look at those hot pink beads. She is a looker. Look at that. She's losing her beads still." And Mrs. Mug, when they first started dating, looked at Mr. Mug and said, "Look at those muscular blue beads of his. I mean, he is a hunk." And so they started dating. And they're getting closer and closer and closer. And you know, finally they said, "It's time to tie the knot. I mean, this is perfect." And they were just, you know, they had a couple of collisions, just minor little things. But, you know, it was all right. It was okay. Until about a month after they got married. It was their first big bump. What? And she looked at him and said, "I can't believe you said that to me." He said, "Well, I can't believe you said that to me. I mean, you've got issues, lady." And she said, "Well, your issues have got issues." And man, there, the beads are flying everywhere at this point, man. They're just, you know, And she went off to her sister, and she said, "Well, you know, he's got anger problems, you know? He's got major, major issues. Can you believe this guy? Can you believe this man?" And the man went off to talk to, I don't know who men really talk to, but I don't know, maybe just thought to himself, looked in the mirror, whatever. But they kind of, they patched it up a little bit, not really. You know, still underlying there. A couple months later, boom, that was another big conflict. Said, "I can't believe you would do that. I can't believe you'd say that. I can't believe, I can't believe, I can't believe." And he's like, "Well, look at you. I mean, come on, you know." And they're getting worse and worse and more tense and more tense. And with every conflict, more and more beads and more and more beads and more and more beads. And Mr. Mug is thinking this: if she wouldn't bump me so hard, if she wouldn't say X or Y or Z, if she wouldn't do that and say that and X, da, 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 then I wouldn't lose my blue beads. And Mrs. Mug is saying, "Well, if he wouldn't, you know, look at me that way, if he wouldn't say those snide little thing under his breath, you know, if he didn't smell so bad in the morning, And I lose my pink beads because of the way that he bumps me all the time." You see, that's not the problem, is it? See, the blue beads, the reason the blue beads come out of Mr. Mug is that they're in there in the first place. Are you taking notes on this? This is really important. This has been fun so far, right? You can go home now, right? I mean, we're kind of done here. Now, and the pink beads. The reason the pink beads come out of Mrs. Mug, because they're there in the first place. She's got issues. And he's got issues. All God's people got issues. We all got stuff. And let me tell you, the Word of God tells you that. And you can say, "Oh, no, not me. Well, no, I don't have issues. She's got issues. I mean, she pushes my buttons, and I react the way I react because it's her fault. And she's saying, no, 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 no. It's him because No. There's stuff inside of each of them. You got stuff inside of you. It's a condition. Jeremiah 17:9, hear this, and hear this well. The heart is deceptive above all things and beyond cure. Beyond cure. Who can know it? I mean, this is such a classic scripture verse. It's from the Old Testament, Jeremiah the prophet. He's looking at the problem of his people, the Israelites who are idolaters, and he's looking at the problems of their idolatry and their giving up on God. And this is what he says, the human heart is deceptive. You know where that word deceptive is in the Hebrew? You're going to love this. You are going to love this. The Hebrew word is, you come to church, you learn. Isn't this good? The Hebrew word, Yaakov. Okay, we have any Hebrew scholars? Yaakov. You know where Yaakov comes from? You know whose proper name this is? Genesis? Son of Isaac? Jacob, yes. I was running out of hints to use for you. Jacob, who, if you've ever read the story of Jacob, which, let me tell you, it's a cool story. But it's a cool story of a lot of dysfunction, isn't it? And Jacob is known as the deceiver. And that is who he is. And it's like Jeremiah is using this word and he's saying, we all got a little bit of Jacob in us. The heart not only deceives, but it deceives itself. It's a deceiver and is deceived. It's wicked. It's beyond cure. It has an incurable disease attached to it. There is a sickness and a disease of the heart. Now, I know that's not what our culture says. That's not what society says. If you just have enough education, right? Just get enough good information in, right? Good stuff in, bad stuff out. And, you know, we're all good people deep down inside. That flies in the face, though, of what Scripture says. We're not all great and good on the inside. There's stuff. There's baggage. There's a sin problem deep within us. And the sooner that you come to terms with that, the sooner that you can agree with that in your own heart of hearts, then you are moving towards that state of healthy emotionalism and, may I say, healthy spirituality. I've got a wounded, wicked heart. Jesus says the same thing. You know, you think that when you come into the New Testament, Jesus is going to say, oh, you're all nice people. You know, come on into heaven. You're all nice people. You know, he doesn't say it. He doesn't say that. In fact, there's a discussion with the Pharisees one day. The Pharisees were the religious people. They were the really conservatives of their day, the legalistic people. And for them, it was all about the law. And one of their laws said you had to wash your hands before you ate. That's what your mom used to tell you, right? Wash your hands before you had dinner. And they saw the disciples who didn't wash their hands, the disciples of Jesus. And they said to Jesus, said, your disciples don't wash their hands, which makes the food unclean. Their hands are unclean. The food's unclean. They eat it. That makes them unclean. And Jesus said, you got it all backwards. That is not how it goes. It's not what goes into a person that makes them unclean. It is what comes out of a person. And then he says these words in Mark chapter 7, verse 21. It is from within. The beast is within. Out of a person's heart that evil thoughts come. And then Jesus gives this long list of a grocery list of sins deep within our heart. The heart is the problem. Some of you know that my mom, when she passed away, some of you know that she had cancer, but it was a certain kind of cancer. It was called multiple myeloma cancer. And it was a cancer of the blood, and it's a very rare kind of cancer. And fortunately, they caught it early, but there's no way, there's nothing that can cure it. They can use chemo to kind of keep it at bay. But here's what happens. It's a blood cancer, which means the blood, the cancerous blood, literally gets pumped by the heart throughout the whole body, and it starts corrupting and infecting and causing problems throughout the whole body. You see this? What this is kind of like what spiritually? It all starts with the heart. It all ends with the heart. The problem is with the heart, and everything follows through and is corrupted through the heart. Let me put it to you this way. What the heart desires, the mind conspires, and the will acquires. See, here's what I mean by that. Whatever you want in your heart of hearts, you know, your pleasure is your treasure. Whatever you desire and whatever you want, the mind will find ways to get it. The mind is going to start to think and cogitate over the particular ways of getting that thing that I want so bad in life. And then the will just says, okay, and let's label it, let's list it, let's work it all out, and the will acquires it. See, what the mind desires, what the heart desires, the mind conspires, and the will acquires. You see the pattern? It all starts with the heart. It's the affections. And if your affections are bad, if the heart is bad, then it's all going to go for us in the wrong direction. Is there any hope? Yes. Y'all remember The Wizard of Oz, right? I still love that. I was so scared of The Wizard of Oz when I was a little kid, right? But you remember the Tin Man. And Frank Baum, who wrote The Wizard of Oz, had a series of books that he wrote about Oz. And you don't learn the backstory of the Tin Man. It's actually called the Tin Woodsman. His name is Nick, by the way. He was a real man. A real man. And he loved a young maiden. But the Wicked Witch of the East, you remember, she was the one where the house came and poof, down on top of. Well, she was very jealous of their love. And so what did the Wicked Witch of the East do? She cursed his axe. He was a woodsman by trade. Cut down wood. And she cursed his axe in such a way so that the axe would get wild and chop off a limb. And then it would chop off the other limb. And then it would chop off his legs. I don't know why they didn't put this part in the movie, you know. I think it would have been interesting to know the backstory, but no, they left it out. And so then the Tin Man fashioned legs for him, arms for him, until his torso was cut. But of course, obviously, the tinsman, did not give the woodsman a heart. And so he went to Oz, didn't he? The great wizard. And some of us may be wondering this morning, is there any hope for my sin-sick, me-centered heart? Is there a wizard who can give me the heart that I need? So Jeremiah is from the Old Testament. Do you know who? There was another prophet by the name of Ezekiel, and he was a contemporary of Jeremiah. They lived at the same time. And Ezekiel has some very powerful words of what is going to come in the New Testament. Hundreds of years down the road, and Ezekiel prophesies the solution for us. This is God speaking, I will give you a new heart. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. God's saying, these human beings have a sin-sick heart. They need a heart transplant. They need to have their old sick heart removed, and they need a brand new heart placed in them. But in order for there to be a heart transplant, what do you need? You need a donor. You need somebody that's going to say, I will give my heart. And the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, stepped forward and said, I will give my heart. Let me tell you, there is no other person who has ever lived or who could ever live who I would want their heart, right? I don't want anybody else's heart because they're all sick just like me. But there is one, only one, whose heart is pure, uncorrupt, stainless, and Jesus came to offer his heart to us. On the operating table of the cross, the great physician took out the heart of his son and offered it to a sin-sick world who have all of us hearts that are corrupt, and he offers that to us. And that new heart, what does it do? It now gives you new urgings, right? Doesn't it? Gives you now a new sense of what is truly right, what is good. You begin to have an affection and a passion for the things of God and not the things of the world. And some of you today, you need to do business with the donor. You need to come square to the throne room, the person of Jesus, and stare it into his eyes and say, I need your heart. I'm asking you to fill my heart, to give me a new passion. I have a condition. I have stuff. And it's ruining my marriage. It's ruining my relationships. It's ruining my life. And only Jesus can mend it. The only one who can mend my heart is the one who made my heart. Can we just say that together? Because it's true. The only one who can mend my heart is the one who made my heart. Some of you need to start with that mending today. You need to begin a relationship and have the Lord start things fresh in you. Now, for those of you who've been Christians for eons, you know that it doesn't end there, does it? That's just the beginning. Because some of that baggage is still there in the wings, still pokes its evil head up every once in a while. And you and I, those of you who've been Christians for a long while, you and I need to be born again, again. And again, and again, and again. Every day is a brand new start, a fresh filling of the Lord in our lives. And we need to make sure that we keep doing that. Or else what happens? My relationship with God grows stale. I don't have the passion that I need to have, should have. Remember we said it all begins with a heart. What happens if every day you wake up and you have got this heart of affection that says, God, I want to love you with all my heart today. Where is that going to take you? Oh, it's going to take you in such wonderful places. Let me assure you that. But some of you need to get refreshed again. You need to be revitalized, revived, resurrected all over again in your heart of hearts. Let Jesus do that today for you. It's the filling of his Spirit in us. It's not according to the law. It's not about praying more, giving more, reading your Bible more, doing. It's about Jesus filling up your heart, who then gives you a passion for all the good stuff, for all the right stuff. Now, there's so much more in this topic about emotions and feelings. We don't have time today. Some of you just need to first and foremost make Jesus the Lord of not just what you do, but what you feel. Make him the Lord of your heart. Let's pray together right now. Let's stand together. Why don't we stand? Lord, we come to you today. Knowing for so many of us, our hearts, that's the problem right there. It's our hearts. And we ask you today to come deep within. Jesus, we need to have that personal touch from you. Thank you that you are the one who is able to do that. You're the one who can mend our hearts. to take away those feelings of selfishness, me-centeredness. Father, our world is broken. People all around us, their hearts are wounded. They are the walking wounded, so many of them, and they need you as well. But here in this place, we commit our hearts and our lives to you. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. If there's anything in you this morning that kind of sparked something, spoke to your heart, there's a few of us that are going to be over in the corner over here, and if you want to come over and pray with us, maybe today's the day for some of you to give your hearts to the Lord, to give your heart to Jesus for the first time in your life. Come over during this next song.
You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. 'Cause you can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. Oh, the joy I've found surrendering my crown at the feet of a king who surrendered everything. And oh, the peace that comes when I'm broken and undone by your unfailing. I can lift my voice and say, you can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now. Sing one more time, just your voices. Cause you can have it all. Every part of my world. Take this life. Amen. We have one more song we're going to sing together. The prayer team is still here. If anybody wants to go and someone to pray with you, I invite you to do that. Let's continue singing together. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Sing now, Jesus, you're still enough. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Fail me yet. Oh. sing this out. I've seen you move.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe. I see you do it again. I see you move. You move the mountains.
Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me, yeah. Never failed me, yeah. Oh, you never failed me, yeah. You never failed me, yeah. You never fail me. Yet.
Jesus, we believe. You are capable to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine. And some of us, Lord, we've doubted. We wonder when we don't see you move. We wonder, are you moving? Are you doing things? But you said that faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. So we don't see you move always, but we believe that you are moving. Because we've seen you move in the past, we've seen you move mountains, and we believe that you can do it again. So whatever we are experiencing today, Lord, I pray for the marriages that are broken today, Lord. I pray for the husbands and the wives that are just against each other, and I pray that there would be this unity in Christ. I pray, Lord, for the kids growing up in these broken homes, that they would see their parents living out the gospel, living out the testimony of Christ. God, I pray for singles who are feeling so alone and longing for that person who's going to fulfill their life, and I pray that they would find that fulfillment in you. Jesus, you're still enough. We believe it. So God, we thank you for what you are doing and what you will continue to do. And we pray this in your name. Amen. All right. Hey, would you be seated? And I would like to invite up Mark from Straight Ahead Ministries, and Sam, our youth pastor, is going to come up. And we're going to hear about this ministry, Straight Ahead, that's happening right in our backyard in Worcester. And so, yeah, welcome. Thanks for being here.
What an awesome time in worship, huh? Yes? Awesome? Hey, Mark, how are you?
I'm doing well. Good morning, Faith Church.
Mark is here from Straight Ahead Ministry. He's going to talk to us a little bit about what is going on there. So go right ahead, sir.
Thanks very much, Sam. So my name again is Mark O'Neill, and I'm from Straight Ahead Ministries. I'm the state coordinator for Straight Ahead Ministries. What that generally means is I manage the relationship between Straight Ahead and all the state's juvenile detention centers. I'm also responsible for recruiting and training and implementing volunteers to go in and meet with juvenile offenders throughout the state. For 30 years, we've been blessed to see Christ transform the lives of juvenile offenders in this state. Right now, we've a lot's happened, actually. And oh, by the way, I should also mention we're throughout the United States. A lot's happened since I was here about 3 years ago. But before I go to that, I want to share a short video that will really share the impact that your support has had on the lives of the youth that we meet with.
I was in a shelter system when I was 5 years old. My mother was homeless, you know what I'm saying? So
my first memory was my mom holding my head underwater in the bathtub.
I seen people in gangs. That was my family. So I got down. I started doing drugs, started selling drugs, drinking, having sex early. I got pregnant at 14.
Jailing for no man at all, especially, you know, a 17-year-old kid. But I hope I just live to see another day, you know what I'm saying?
When I got my daughter taken away from me and I started doing coke again, I think that was like the lowest for me because I was so strung out on drugs. Like, I really couldn't focus. I couldn't get my priorities straight.
I ended up getting locked up when I was 13 years old in California. So I ended up living in and out of lockup. When I was 14, I ran away from California to Massachusetts.
Straight Ahead Ministry has always been about seeing Jesus transform the lives of juvenile offenders. When we get to see yesterday's delinquents become tomorrow's leaders, then we really see God complete his great work.
So when Sheila Ray came and she shared her testimony is when I decided to give my life to Christ, and that was over 2 years ago. Being here at Straight Ahead, they gave me opportunities to grow and to grow in my purpose and grow in who I am in God.
I want to work with juvenile delinquents like myself. I want to work with girls and boys in my situation because you don't have a lot of that. And I really want to be able to say I did it so you can.
You know what I'm saying? I have dreams of being successful, I have dreams of having these things, but, you know, we can't get to that certain place to take us there. 10 years from now, I want to have my own house. Hopefully I can start a family.
When God gets a hold of a life and begins to change that and alter them toward a vision that's a lot bigger than just saying no to drugs or just saying no to crime, to actually saying yes to calling that is in them even before they were born, things begin to change. Communities change, families change, whole systems change. Straight Ahead's possible because of people like you who get behind this mission. It really is what makes the difference.
You've never met Scott, as featured there, Scott Larson, our president. Scott and his wife, Hannah, started Straight Ahead Ministries 30 years ago. We're in our 30th year. This is our 30-year anniversary, so we're really happy and blessed to see all the work that God has done throughout this ministry in that time. Before I go any further, I would like to introduce a work colleague and a good friend of mine, Lena Tu. Lena is working with us right now, going into girls' facilities and helping them transition back into the communities. I want her to share part of her story.
Good morning, everyone. Again, my name is Lena. I've been working with Straight Ahead for over 5 years. This has been a big blessing to my life. In fact, I was once a lost and a broken soul, like these kids that you just seen in the video. Growing up, my childhood wasn't really a childhood. I went through a lot of abuse, verbally, physically, and sexually. And there were many times as a young kid I wanted to die. I didn't find any purpose for my life. I found no hope. It was very dark, and I was very lost into it. When I was 16, 8 months and a half pregnant with my son, I committed a crime that turned my whole life upside down. At that point, I wanted to die even more. But I felt like God always has been there, but I never really fully get to know who he really was. And I met Straight Ahead when I was 19 at one of the facility I was at, where I was doing majority of my time up till I was 21. During that time, I learned about God. I learned not only that, through the people who I got in their heart and the relationship I was having them with them that I never really had with anybody. I was able to experience that, like, wow, this is amazing. I learned about forgiveness, and that was the biggest thing in my life, because if I didn't know about forgiveness, how to forgive myself and others, I wouldn't be able to have the courage to stand in front of you today. Sorry, guys, I'm just really nervous. But when I was 23, I got a chance to get my son back, and Straight Ahead supported me all the way through. And if it wasn't for Straight Ahead, I don't think I would be able to get a chance to get him back. So I got a second chance to be a mother to my son after all the years I have missed. And I always had a passion of working with young people, because the things that I was going through, and I felt like nobody was able to understand me, and I felt like, wow, like if I can able to live out my passion and teach them about God and show them there is a light and there is a way. Because of Straight Ahead Ministry, I became who I am today. They kept me on the path, especially the spiritual part, because if I didn't have Straight Ahead Ministry in my life, I would have got lost again. I would like to share a verse with you to show you to understand, well, for me, the way I see it is like, wow, because of these people who follow that, made me want to follow that. Galatians 6:2, carry each other's burden is a way to fulfill the law of Christ. And that's who we are today as Christ follower, is to help each other out, regardless, family, friends or not. It's just, that's who God was all about, is helping each other out. You know, even though that is not my kid, but I saw that kid lost, and I want to able to lift him up. And because a Straight Ahead Ministry taught me that, that's who I want to become and follow that. So thank you, and like I said, it was volunteers who started this organization. It was Hannah who raised volunteers. It was all about people coming together, raising support, be the volunteer, be the resource, financially supporting the ministry, made who we are today for 30 years. So thank you. It's a blessing to be here and able to share that part of my life with you.
Amen.
Thanks, Lena. And in case you haven't seen them, all three of Lena's beautiful children are here today, so I hope you get to see them at some point, including Ethan over here. So without your generosity, Lena's story may have been much different. The stories of the youth that you saw in that video could have been much different. In the last 3 years since I last spoke at this church, we've been blessed to be able to recruit, train, and implement nearly 100 volunteers throughout the state of Massachusetts. In this state alone, there are 52 juvenile detention centers. Fortunately, we're in about 37 of them. That's about 70%. We've got a ways to go, and we need your help.
All right, so how do we help? How do we get involved?
So I'll tell you, the average cost... Lena and I are both faith-based missionaries, and we rely on financial support to live our lives and to do the ministry. The average cost to run an average juvenile detention center in Massachusetts is about $1,800 a year. It's about $150 a month and about $15 per youth. Each detention center holds about 10 to 12 kids. So I'd love to have you know that. All your support goes to, again, recruiting and training volunteers, putting Bibles and books and other resources in the hands of these youth, helping set up special events, running our Christmas Gift of Hope program, where we look to put a Christmas gift in the hands of every kid in every lockup in the state of Massachusetts. It's nearly 600 kids. For many of these kids, it's the only Christmas present they'll get. So that's where your support goes. I hope you'll consider joining us on this mission. You should know before I leave that this month the board of directors approved a $100,000 match. So that means every dollar contributed to both Lena and I gets matched. Wow. So if you'd like to take part of that and join us on this mission, we'd love to talk to you more after the service.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much. Let me just real quick pray for you guys, all right? Father God, thank you so much for the opportunity that we've had to connect with Lena and Mark. And I just pray, God, for the ministry that has taken place at Straight Ahead Ministry. May we unite together to continue to connect and transform the lives that are broken. We pray all this in your name. Amen. So thank you guys so much. If you guys want more information about what is going on at Straight Ahead Ministry, they have a table, and you can go right after the service onto them and hang out with them. There's also a lunch that it's going to be happening right after church. So please consider joining us for the lunch. You can get to know them a little bit more as well. We're going to right now transition into our offering time, tithes and offerings. And I just want to share with you a quick verse. We're going to make this quick. And I want to share with you guys this verse, and it's from Malachi. And it says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be no, there will not be room enough to store it. This speaks to the fact that we can trust God. And in this area of finances, that we can trust God in our finances, that He wants to actually bless us because we are willing to have a giving heart. So right now we're going to be worshiping God. We're going to be taking up our morning offering. If you're new here today, we would like for you to just consider taking a Connect card that you will find in the back of the seat in front of you and fill out as much as possible. Bring that Connect card to the Connect Center for a gift from us. Don't feel obligated to give. But for the rest of us, this is a time for us to give. And we have these slips right here. You will find them in front of the seat, on your seats, actually. So you can find this. We want to challenge you guys. This is a 90-day challenge for you to consider giving for 3 months, 10% of the tithe, and pretty much as a response of this scripture to test that God is faithful, even in your giving. So would you consider give and filling this out and telling us that you're gonna take on this 90-day challenge? There's also a few ways, other ways to give. The ushers can now start collecting the offerings. You could drop this off as well in the offering bucket as they come, or you could bring it to the Connect Center. There's also other ways to give. We want to make this as easy as possible for you. One of the ways is you can give online. So you could go to our website, faithauburn.org, and you could select to set up a recruiting gift. This is the easiest way to do it. My wife and I do this, and simple, and for you to just right away, we don't always bring cash or anything like that or our checkbooks. This is a great way for you to give online as well. So you could also download our app store. Yeah, we're technologically cool. We have an app, it's called Faith Church Auburn. You could find it in the iOS devices, the iPhone or Android devices. You could download it and select give to set up a recruiting gift or give on your app as well. Thank you very much. We have one more thing that we want to share with you.
So I just wanted to recap. Yesterday was Hope for Worcester, Day of Hope. And for those of us who volunteered yesterday, it was great to see your faces, see you serving the community. And it was a lot of fun to come together. And as a church, we've been collecting shoes. And we collected somewhere over 400 pairs of shoes as a church together. So that's pretty incredible.
Yeah.
But as kind of an incentive for the small groups to get involved, I did a little competition to see whose small group could collect the most shoes, and the top small group would get a $60 gift card to Ronnie's and do an ice cream party. So the top small group was Ricky and Rachel Peterson. Are they here? Yeah? Are they here? Sweet. Rachel.
There you are.
So their group collected 114 pairs of shoes.
What?
And so that's incredible.
That's
Payless.
Awesome.
I'm pretty sure Payless closed down because of them. So Payless Shoe Source. But what they've decided to do is take out to ice cream the second small group with the most shoes, which was Lynn Ferracco's group. Is Lynn in here? Lynn Ferracco? Yeah, Lynn.
Lynn.
They collected 100 pairs of shoes. So just wanted to highlight that. Thank you, small groups, all the small groups who participated in that and brought in shoes. So that was a lot of fun.
And these are all examples of how powerful giving is. So would you continue to connect with us and continue to unite with us as we worship God through our giving and also make a difference with what God has given us as well. Thank you guys so much for coming this Sunday. I hope you have a beautiful Sunday. It's going to be like 90s outside. Enjoy your Sunday. Have a great week. God bless. We come alive.
is the